Welcome to worship from Living Hope Church in Sarnia, Ontario. As we join together for worship, let us go to our God in a time of prayer. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. You have created this world in splendor, and your spirit renews the face of the earth. You have made us in your image, and you renew us in the image of your Son. You have given us your law, and your spirit leads us in the ways of righteousness. You have gathered us into your covenant of grace, and you have written your law on our hearts. You promise to make all things new, and you give us your spirit as the first fruits of a renewed creation. All glory be to you, Lord our God, giver of every good and perfect gift. Alleluia. Amen. We will now have our opening song. This morning, we are going to continue our study of Peter's first letter, and our reading today is a longer one. We are going to be reading from 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13, and going through chapter 3, verse 12. Before we get to that reading, I think there's a couple of things which we need to acknowledge. First of all, it's been a hard week around the world. Anger, violence, the destruction of property, and theft have been unleashed in so many places, and in particular, our cities. Not only are we dealing with the frustration and pain associated with the global pandemic caused by COVID-19, the injustice within our systems of power are again laid bare. It's adding to the pain of many people. The world is not as it's supposed to be. We live in a broken world. The hurting is real, and we should not, and none of it should be dismissed. The results are seen in what we now witness around the world. So the question is, how do we respond as a Christian community? How does the church react to all that we see around us? How do we do that without sounding condescending or simplistic or judgmental? Well, now is the time for the church to live up to its calling to be a prophetic voice for the kingdom of God. Now is the time for us to continue speaking with love, grace, and truth. This is the only solution to the problem. If we are to be that living temple, which Peter describes for us in this letter, if we are to be that living temple, that visible presence of God in this world that has come in Jesus Christ, If we are to be a people who are filled with the Holy Spirit, declaring the word of God to the world, well, then we need to be a people who are rooted in that word. We need to be a community that is shaped by love, grace, and truth, not in name only, but in reality. Now, this is not easy. In our previous reading from the last time, 1 Peter 2, verse 12 says, "Live such good lives among the pagans," that is, the nations, "that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us." In a world and society that is hurting, we are called not to abandon the world, but to be for the world. Herman Bavinck once said, "Christians must experience a twofold conversion. They must first be converted from the world in one sense, and then converted to the world in another sense." The kingdom of God is not of this world. That is, it does not find the source for its power and legitimacy from the world, but our service within the kingdom of God is for the world. So how can we as a Christian community in times such as this be for the world? Well, not by supporting violence and destruction, but by promoting peace and justice for all. And so the next section that we're going to read from Peter's letter, the one that we will be considering for today, it's a longer reading that, as I said, stretches from chapter 2, verse 13, all the way into chapter 3, verse 12. Now, within this longer reading, the apostle is turning our attention to the practical application of the gospel to daily living. He is speaking about relationships, both in society and within the Christian household. So how do we as people who believe that the God who made the world and has now redeemed the world in Jesus Christ, how do we now live in this world? Let's take a look at what the apostle says in our reading for today from chapter 2, beginning at verse 13. Before we go to God's word, let's ask for his blessing. Lord, we pray that you will bless the reading of your word, that your spirit will open our hearts and minds that we might hear your spirit-filled word for us. Help us to listen to your word in a proper frame of mind. And Lord, instruct us through this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning at verse 13. "Submit yourselves to the for the Lord's sake to every authority instituted among men, whether to the king as the supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish men. Live as free men, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as servants of God. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the brotherhood of believers. Fear God. Honor the king. Slaves, submit to yourselves to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and considerate, but also to those who are harsh. For it is commendable if a man bears up under the pain of unjust suffering because he is conscious of God. But how is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. To this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin and no deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Wives, in the same way, be submissive to your husbands, so that if any of them do not believe the word, they may be won over without words by the behavior of their wives, when they see the purity and reverence of your lives. Your beauty should not come from outward adornment, such as braided hair and the wearing of gold jewelry and fine clothes. Instead, it should be that of your inner self, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is of great worth in God's sight. For this is the way the holy women of the past, who put their hope in God, used to make themselves beautiful. They were submissive to their own husbands, like Sarah, who obeyed Abraham and called him her master. You are her daughters if you do what is right and do not give way to fear. Husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives and treat them with respect, as the weaker partner and as heirs with you of the gracious gift of life, so that nothing will hinder your prayers. Finally, all of you live in harmony with one another. Be sympathetic, love as brothers, be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult, but with blessing. Because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. For whoever would love life and see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from deceitful speech. He must turn from evil and do good. He must seek peace and endure it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. So what do you do with what the apostle says to us in this longer reading from chapter 2 into chapter 3? This message from Paul, if we just take it on face value, this message from Peter, it might sound inappropriate and maybe even offensive in light of our present circumstances. When Peter speaks about submitting to the government, when Peter speaks about slaves and masters and husbands and wives, what he says is not always easy to accept and receive as the authoritative word of God. In fact, what he says sounds bad. It's as if he's condoning evil power structures, such as that which was found in the Roman Empire. It's as if he is condoning an evil institution like slavery and the subjection of women. A public reading of 1 Peter 2, verse 13, into chapter 3, verse 7, will be offensive to many people in today's world. So what are we to do? Are we to love it and apply it strictly? Or do we simply reject it? Well, we need to avoid two extremes. We need to avoid fundamentalism and a rejection of the word. Fundamentalism takes what Peter writes about submission to government, slaves and masters, husbands and wives, and it says that nothing has changed in this world since he wrote these things. So a fundamentalist would say, support the government, submit to ill treatment from those whose power is legitimized by the state, and husbands, rule over your wives and household. Now, others would go to the opposite extreme and say that this letter is so out of date, it is offensive to our evolved sensibilities. Therefore, don't read it. Just ignore it. Get rid of it. Now, either of these approaches is not helpful. The fundamentalist and the person who rejects this teaching fails to read the Word of God from a spirit-filled understanding. And so if we are to understand this section of Peter's letter, we need to have a spirit-filled understanding of God's word. Here's what I mean by that. First of all, you must understand and believe that there is always an historical context to Scripture. Today's world and society are not the same one into which Peter first wrote these words. You cannot take the prescriptions and apply them without understanding the historical context. Now, second, with that reality in mind, we must also remember that a changing world does not allow us to simply reject the word. A spirit-filled reading will always hear the word in a way that allows us to understand its true meaning in light of the coming of God, the coming of the kingdom of God in Jesus Christ. That's how we understand all of Scripture. We read it as a spirit-filled text that reveals the God who brings the kingdom of God in Jesus Christ. So between the prescriptions that are given by Peter when he speaks about the relationship between us and the government in chapter 2, verses 13 through 17, when he speaks about households in chapter 2, verses 18 through 25, and what he says about husbands and wives in chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, we have to remember that the overall theme is to understand this in light of the coming of the kingdom of God in Jesus Christ. Now, the overall theme is stated right there in verse 13, where, in a sense, what Peter says is, submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to the authority of every human institution. Let's consider further what that means. At the root of our calling to be God's people in a time such as the one in which we now live, there is a word that goes against the grain of everything that the world is going to say to you. You know what that word is. It's the word submit, the very first word there in verse 13. That word goes against everything that the world says to us today. The apostle, though, says submit. Now, looking at this word in its original language, Scott McKnight correctly defines submission this way. He says, submission is to order oneself under or according to a given relationship. Let me say that again. Submission is to order oneself under or according to a given relationship. Now, if we understand this world from its gospel perspective, if we understand that the word submit is a gospel word, then this is all about being in the rhythms of God's grace. It's about not giving ourselves over to the abusive systems of power that dehumanize us or others. We don't have to give ourselves over to abusive systems of power. Submission, according to Scripture, submission in this letter and in the rest of Scripture is always with the understanding that we as Christians submit ourselves to be under God and in obedience to Him. Now that makes all the difference, doesn't it? We are to be under God so that we can live in obedience to Him. And so the relationship between believers and the state, between servants and masters, husbands and wives, these are just three examples given to us by the apostle in order to help us understand our lives in submission to God and living them according to the values of the kingdom of grace. And so our text for today, the specific text and the meaning of this section, which I want for us to understand today, comes to us from 1 Peter 3, verses 8 and 9. At the end of describing these relationships, the Apostle Peter says to us, "Finally, all of you, live in harmony with one another. Be sympathetic, love as brothers, be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult, but with blessing. Because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing." Ultimately, this is the kingdom-focused perspective of this section which we have read from Peter's letter. The reason for the call to submission is so that we might be citizens of God's kingdom, living within the rhythms of His grace. Let's take a closer look then at what he says. The reason for the call to submission is also scattered in hints throughout the reading. Namely, we are called to do what is right and good. Remember, this section of Peter's letter is related to that command in 1 Peter 2, verse 12, which calls on us to live good and honorable lives among all people. Now, in the section dealing with our relationship with governors, Peter says in verse 15, he says, "For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish men." In the second section dealing with servants and masters, or as it says in our NIV translation, slaves and masters, the end of verse 20 says, "If you suffer for doing good and endure it, this is commendable before God." You need to understand that Christ identifies himself with the marginalized, the outcast, and those who are without power. Christ identifies with those who are outside and abused by the systems of power. And then in the final section, that third section dealing with wives and husbands, in chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, it says, "If any one of them does not believe the word, they may be won over without words by the behavior of their wives when they see the purity and reverence of your lives." As I said the last time, we need to always be proclaiming the gospel. And sometimes we will use words to do that. More often, we should live good and honorable lives. Just as powerful as the proclamation of the word is the witness of God's beloved people when they live out the reality of God's kingdom in their daily lives. When we live out the values of God's kingdom in all areas of life, then we are also loudly and clearly proclaiming God's gospel. We are a living presence. We are a prophetic voice for the Creator God, for the God who has redeemed this whole universe. Now, what Peter is saying, that as we are this living temple, as we are this prophetic voice proclaiming the Creator and Redeemer of the universe, that includes how we live in all of our societal and family relationships. You know, it's too easy when we hear passages such as the one I've read to you to get bogged down in all of the details and miss that bigger picture. Again, we should not be fundamentalists in our approach to Scripture. This is not a text where we can simply say that it is to be understood literally. Government is not to be obeyed unconditionally. Slavery is never justified. Jewelry, braided hair, and fine clothes are not in and of themselves evil. But nor can we just reject this word. There is a context. And if we know that context, we see the unchanging meaning of the text. Now, briefly, here's what I mean by that. If we go back to the goal of everything in this text, in chapter 3, verses 8 and 9, there we come to in essence, a summary statement of everything that the apostle is saying to us. Again, I'll read these words to you. 1 Peter 3, verses 8 and 9. Finally, all of you, live in harmony with one another. Be sympathetic. Love as brothers. Be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult, but with blessing. Because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. That's it, really. That's the goal of everything, that we might be a blessing. The Church of Jesus Christ, and by way of extension, the whole Christian community as we live and work in this world, we are called to be a blessing to the world. Now more than ever, blessing, which is a good word that speaks of peace and life, that is what we ought to be bringing to the table. The blessing of God's kingdom speaks of peace from violence and viruses. And it speaks of a life that is lived under and is flourishing under God's grace. You know, at its best, the church in this world proclaims the blessing of God's kingdom for all people and all circumstances. When we are at our best, that's what we do. We speak of God's kingdom of grace for all people in all circumstances. At our worst, when the church is at its worst, we buy into the powers and structures of this world, and we put ourselves outside of justice and peace and grace. So again, now is the time. Now is the time for us as a community to be a living temple. Now is the time for us to live within the rhythms of God's grace. We don't repay evil with evil, but with blessing. That blessing is a good word. It's a word or words that are never lost to the wind. You see, a word of blessing is powerful because we as Christians believe that words have power. The Lord who spoke the universe into being has placed his powerful word in us. Words spoken by authoritative persons in proper contexts have the power to shape human life. If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, then live your life for God's kingdom of grace. And when you do, the words you speak have the power to shape life according to the rhythms of God's grace. So do you see the seriousness of the calling which you receive? Don't get bogged down in the things that might sound bad or offensive. Do you see the seriousness of the calling which Peter is giving to us in this part of his letter? It's a call to be a blessing. You can't simply give lip service to the Christian faith. This is a word that needs to invade our hearts. It needs to transform our lives, and it needs to lead you to be a blessing to others. And it begins in the Christian household. So we can't meet together as a congregation. It actually begins in the Christian household. And what you as parents teach your children will then go out in order to be a blessing for the rest of society. You see, if we take God's word seriously, if we don't reject it, if we don't simply become fundamentalists, if we take God's word seriously, it transforms our church community. And by extension, the church of Jesus Christ, as it lives and works in this world, will be a blessing to the world. We will be that living temple, which earlier Peter said we are called to be. It's no accident that the apostle speaks of relationships both in society and in the Christian home from chapter 2, verse 13, all the way through chapter 3, verse 7, before he gives us that general command to be a blessing in chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. You see, what is proclaimed in worship is a word of blessing that is to be for all of life. So then, as Christians, we belong to our God and Father through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Through his resurrection, we believe that new life has come, and we now live in the beginning of a new creation. And so, empowered by the Spirit of Christ, we belong under God's authority, because that is where true freedom is found. We are free. We are free from sin so that we can live for the kingdom. And this freedom calls us to be a blessing to the world. And when we are a blessing to the world, God is glorified in us. Amen. Let us go to God in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for calling us and redeeming us to be your people. We thank you that you are our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sustainer. Lord, in this Pentecost season, we give thanks for the gift of your Holy Spirit, who breathes into these words which we have read from Peter's letter and reveals to us your living and active word that speaks of your blessing for all of life. Lord, as we have heard your word, may we live out that word through our words and action. Lord, we pray for your church universal, wherever your people are in this world. Lord, may we be a light for your gospel of grace and truth. Lord, we also know there's a lot of hurting in this world, and where there is violence, where there is a lot of unrest and protesting, Lord, we pray for peace. And above all, Lord, we pray that justice will be served in this world, and we trust, Lord, that you will work in our hearts, and that you will bring justice where there is injustice. And so, Lord, help us as your people to be a light for your grace and your truth. Lord, we pray for an end to this virus, which is still among us. We know, Lord, that you are stronger than any disease. And so again, Lord, we continue to pray for an end to the virus. We also pray, Lord, for those within our congregation who are feeling who aren't feeling well, or who have struggles in their lives, who feel in particular ways the burden of being isolated. We pray that your peace will be upon them. Lord, again, we pray for those who mourn for loved ones who have passed away. Lord, since we have been unable to gather, we continue to remember Simon Timestra, the Caldway family, and also, Lord, the Visser family. As they mourn for loved ones, Lord, continue to surround them with your grace and peace. We also want to pray, Lord, for Dick Metzler as he receives treatment in the hospital. Thank you for protecting him from more harm. We ask, Lord, that you will touch him and that you will give him a complete healing. Lord, as we go into this new week, we pray that you will be our guide, and that we might do all things, that we might be a blessing to others, and that you might be glorified in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Changes not thy compassion, save me.
At this time, I'd also like to give you an announcement that the deacons will be holding a food drive for the local food bank for Inn of the Good Shepherd, and so you will see a note about that in the weekly bulletin, which has been emailed to you or maybe which you've received. Take a look at that and remember in a couple of weeks to take part in this food drive so that we can be a blessing to our community as well. At this time, I invite you to receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.